People would talk about Tony being sexy all the time. They didn't talk about his acting, it was always how sexy he was. He was one of the first sex symbols around in those days. I mean, the only one. There wasn't anybody else that looked like him. They always tried to copy him, but he was the original.
He's a great sex symbol, and a teen sex symbol, of course. And then he became a movie star. But to begin with, he was a sex symbol before Brando, James Dean, and Elvis.
He was a real actor, not just a pretty face and handsome, but an actor.
All the actors were completely controlled. Everybody was under salary. The simple result of that was, quite frankly, it was an assembly line that also managed to produce some of the very best movies that Hollywood has ever produced.
Cut it out. You're supposed to be a hard guy. What are you acting like, a kid?
And here they are. Handsome, vigorous, dynamic, Tony Curtis.
Let all the sons of the 40 thieves who fear not to attack the Caliph's palace step forward.
I never went to school.
I started working when I was 9 years old with a magician in the tent show. If I quit now and take that job in that factory, I'll be there for the rest of my life. I know trouble when I see it.
How could I cause you any trouble?
By doing just what you're doing right now. Dog eat dog. In brief, from now on, the best of everything is good enough for me.
The Tony Curtis hairstyle was something that caught on everywhere. I mean, in the UK as well. And again, it was almost like an act of rebellion. It kind of changed everything, really. The idols that came along. I mean, James Dean's hair would have been quite as bouffant if Tony hadn't done that first.
Never before him had frenzied fans torn off the clothes of a star. He became a pop culture phenomenon.
Being a movie star is great fun and wonderful. It's also a lot of work, and you give up your private life. So there's a lot of setbacks, and there's a lot of struggle. And sometimes young people find it very difficult.
Marilyn and I met in 1948. Her hair was a little red. But she was wearing see-through blouses then. So you saw a little bit of the nipple. Ooh. But we made love. And it was a fabulous experience for both of us. She was very much like a young girl. But everything was an experience for her.
You're not giving yourself a chance. Don't fight it. Relax.
Tony was unhappy with her. He was very unhappy with her. And so when they saw the dailies, we all went to see him. And he sat in the back and he said, kissing her is like kissing Hitler.
Everybody thinks that they would like to be famous. But when it comes down to it, it's not the bed of roses that they suppose. For a while it's great, they get invited to parties, film shoots, media promotions, everything is great fun for a while. But then the various pressures fall upon them. They lose their privacy, they have a media that is always out for negative stories about them, because as fast as the media put people on a pedestal, the next thing is they want to see them knocked off.
When I saw him in Defiant Ones, I said, yeah, Tony really rang a gong here.
And I'll be Charlotte Petite.
No question about the fact that what Tony did could have ruined his career. Absolutely. Because America was vehemently racist. And so for this film to be done then was a daring step forward. And the artists who played in that picture also put a lot on the line. Because if white America did not like black people, and some famous, high-profile young white actor was emerging, then that meant that his career was in great jeopardy.
that Tony is somebody that when the camera is on him, he becomes like, you know, all charming and everything. And when it's off, he doesn't exist. There's sort of like, you know, something that is like all the air taken out of a balloon. And for him, it's very unfortunate because that is probably the worst possible personality to become famous because, you know, fame is always up and down, up and down.
One of my favorite things about him was when his close-up was happening, he would always touch the camera. And then I'd say to him, you know, the camera was there, and then touch the camera. I said, why do you touch the camera? It loves me, baby, it loves me.
Tony Curtis as the great Leslie, gallant lover and heroic daredevil.
After The Great Race brought him more of the spotlight he craved, Tony's popularity declined.
Tony Curtis desperately was clinging to his fame, and his fame was turning sour in his own hands as he was moving ahead.
Why did 13 women open their doors willingly to this stranger? The Boston Strangler stars Tony Curtis in a powerful characterization unlike anything he has ever portrayed on the screen.
In the case of Tony Curtis, of course, he had one extremely famous daughter, Jamie Lee Curtis, and it might have been, could have come a point where he felt himself in competition with his own daughter.
It's uncanny. You really studied that lady, haven't you?
I sort of felt that sometimes, like Marilyn was there helping me do it, because I don't know how I came up with a lot of that stuff. I have no idea. And Tony was like, wow, I was very similar to her. How did you do that? I said, I have no clue.
I think Tony Curtis is a brilliant actor, because he's has no pretension at all.
He still has some sort of a popularity with youth. Today people still remember Tony Curtis when many other actors they've forgotten about.
He's in a class of his own in terms of what he could do and what his abilities dramatically and comedically.
I was the prince who was a thief. I was the son of Ali Baba. And man, I did it with all my heart.